Ladies and gentlemen, it's an honor to introduce our afternoon chairperson who's joined us. Let's put our hands together for Dr. Prashant Bode, who's the director, Clinisearch. He's a pharmacologist with more than 24 years of experience in regulatory affairs, quality compliance and systems, and global clinical research, phase 1-3, and pharmacovigilance, API, toxicology formulation development, bioavailability, bioequivalent studies, pharmacokinetics. His professional experience as a director at Clinisearch, he also has been the proprietor, consultant, pharmaceutical research and development, and this is since June 2014. He's also served as the director of operations, Medanta Duke Research Institute, Medanta, the Medicity, and also has served as the associate director, clinical operations, and office head, Sri Lanka, for Quintiles Research. Ladies and gentlemen, let's hear it for Dr. Bode. Thank you very much for joining us, Dr. Bode. He shall be chairing this session, the afternoon session, and also moderating the next panel discussion, where we have experts coming together and pondering over biosimilars in India, what's next, consideration for long-term market sustainability and market access strategies, opportunities and commercial challenges. On the session, we'd like to invite Dr. Sameer Kulkarni. He's recognized as a leader in biosimilars product development, with about 17 years of overall experience ranging from process development to business strategy. He recently founded BioCogenate Life Sciences Private Limited, which focuses on developing preclinical packages for biosimilars. His early associations include leadership tenures in biologics development organizations such as Intas Biopharmaceuticals, Dr. Reddy's Lab, USV Limited, to name some. He holds about 11 patent applications in process development and several research publications to his credit. Let's put our hands together. Welcome, Dr. Sameer Kulkarni. Our session is also going to have inputs by Dr. Arun Bhatt, who's a consultant, clinical research and development. He has an extensive experience spanning 3 decades in the Indian pharmaceutical sector in clinical research, drug development, and regulatory affairs. He's worked as a consultant in pharmaceutical medicine and clinical pharmacology, and his past positions that he has held include President, Clinivent Research Private Limited, which is a CRO. He's also served as a CEO, CMI India Private Limited, the Medical Director, Novartis Limited. He's also been the earlier President of the Indian Society for Clinical Research and the Joint Editor-in-Chief for Perspectives in Clinical Research, the Journal of ISCR. He's a recipient of the Drug Information Association's Outstanding Service Award and has also delivered the prestigious Professor UK Sate Oration. A qualified assessor for NHBA accreditation, let's put our hands together for Dr. Arun Bhatt. On stage, we'd also once again like to welcome Dr. Ranjan Chakraborty, who's the Vice President and Head Global Biolabs and Standards at USP. Let's put our hands together. Welcome Dr. Ranjan Chakraborty. We are also joined by Dr. Pankaj Thakur, who is the Assistant General Manager, Hetero Drugs Limited. Let's put our hands together and welcome Dr. Pankaj Thakur on stage. Ladies and gentlemen on the panel, we were going to have inputs by Dr. Kalpesh Shah, however, from Reliance Life Sciences. However, due to a surprise FDA audit, he is unable to make it to the conference and sends his apologies. And with that, time now to begin with the discussion. Over to you, Dr. Bode.
Good afternoon. I think everybody must have had good lunch and probably trying to feel sleepy, but we'll try to keep you awake. And fortunately, this is not a lecture with slide presentation, so you have less chance of sleeping, but you have no option but listen to our panelists and me. So let's begin. We have a diverse panel members here, one from the development side, one from the clinical side, one from the regulatory side, or maybe reference standard sides, and one from the Indian market perspective side. So we'll deliberate on several aspects. Biosimilar has, of course, everybody knows that it is different from chemical similars, or in the sense that the development people also have to have some knowledge and insight about patients' conditions, therapeutics, And so also vice versa, the doctors using the product also need to have the product insight. And our focus is going to be on this aspect as well as frontiers of entire global market, not only Indian market, and perspectives about that. So we'll begin with first thought about doctors' involvement in patient treatment and the product. Dr. Arun Bhatt.
Good afternoon. A quiz for you. In post-lunch, everybody looks similarly drowsy. So with all due respect to all of you, we'll try to keep you awake. I think most of us have heard this in the morning that it's a very complex area and development is a very complex area. But as a medical expert from industry, I like to understand this as in a very simple way. So there's a cartoon with me which I couldn't show, but a doctor is telling a patient, I will give you a biosimilar. She says, why don't you give me bio exact? So that's the challenge, that how exact you are, even if you are a similar. And another analogy I can give you is like, it's a younger brother coming after about 20 years of biologic, but the brother has to behave in the same way as the original elder brother. These are the challenges. Now, we have heard so much from industry in the morning, regulations, manufacturing, but I'm asking a question that, is there any practicing doctor here? Thank you, sir. If you are there, I'm very happy because I'm talking on your behalf in a way. I'm a doctor, but I'm not practicing right now. Recently, there was a survey done in USA last year where they looked at about 1,200 US physicians, which included oncologists, gastroenterologists, hematologists, dermatologists, rheumatologists, nephrologists, those who have been using on biosimilars. And the question was about what is the knowledge, attitude, and practice about biosimilars. Now you would be surprised that in USA, even the users of biosimilar, there's a gap in their knowledge about the definition of biologic, biosimilar, approval process, the concept of totality of evidence, interchangeability. All these are gaps in US physicians. The word interchangeability we use a lot in the morning, that can you interchange the product? And this is a risk in India we are going to run. I'm sure as companies in the market with cutthroat competition, we are going to shift people from brand A to B to C, which is already happening right now. And this risk is a bigger risk because when we come to it later, I'll show you why the risk is there. First of all, it's difficult to judge for a doctor in practice whether when you change from brand A to B, it works or not, you can't make out. These are all chronic conditions. If a patient of cancer does not respond, I will not blame the drug or the brand. I'll just blame the disease. So I won't even know whether it works or not. That's one risk we have. But it's very obvious that interchangeability is a very higher standard of biosimilarity compared to just biosimilarity. And that's why US FDA has got special guidelines. So I would actually request my friends in India that let's not push for this switching of brands for biosimilars. For chemicals is okay, generics is okay. But if you do that, we are ultimately going to kill ourselves with issues which are beyond our control. I'll talk about them a little later. This brings to me something very interesting which I saw in a paper from Tufts University. This is just about last week's discussion. The discussion focused on ways to improve manufacturing of biosimilars to make it less expensive, which is going to happen in maybe few years' time. But as a part of that, there was a very interesting chart comparing countries, their sales potential, and uptake by doctors. You would be surprised that in Europe and USA, the markets are big for biosimilars, but the uptake by doctors is low. As compared to India and China, the markets are small in dollar terms, but uptake is huge. This to me is a surprise, because if US doctors are not aware of what is biosimilar and are not willing to write, are our doctors willing to write without knowing this? That's the question in my mind. And I don't have a survey, but I'm part of a group of my batchmates from KM Hospital, all doctors like me, and they were impressed by a media report in Times of India about biosimilar a new invention, how cheap they are, how great they are, then I have to explain that this is not something cheap and good so fast. Let's understand what it is. They all assume that if I can change one generator to another generic, I can also do that. That's other reality in India. And so if they are prescribing it, if they are unaware prescribers, are we hurting ourselves in the bargain? That's my question. Second is the question of cost comes up. Biologics are costly, but biosimilars are not very cheap. If you compare a chemical innovator brand and a generic brand, you might find that generic brand is about 10% of the original innovator in terms of cost. But biosimilars today, for example, I looked at cost of Herceptin biosimilars. Compared to the original brand, Herceptin, where I think even Roche brought down the price to about 75,000 rupees in India, the other brands about 30-40% cheaper, not more. So the question for a doctor would be, can I sacrifice the chance of giving a drug which is probably not biosimilar by global standards to my patients for some saving of 10,000 rupees, etc. Because obviously ultimately those who are affording only will buy this drug. So if somebody is affording 75,000 rupees, why would you give them something which is cheaper but may not work? This is a question in doctors' minds. Second is Dr. Kukreja and I discuss about the number of patients in a trial. One doesn't know whether those 100 patient trials will really, you know, kind of impress a doctor in India in a complex indication. Because when you look at the similar trials being done abroad, for example, I looked at for Herceptin, companies have populations of about 800 patients, 400 on biologic, 400 on biosimilar. Obviously, that requires a lot of money, a lot of courage, risk taking, etc., which we can't do that. I understand that. But by not doing that, can we justify a small trial showing it's biosimilar? That's one question. Now, that brings to mind the last issue that we are in the morning, we have discussed a lot, but we have forgotten one part, pharmacovigilance. Now, for those of us who do not know, biosimilar, biologic, PVG is not same as a chemical generic PVG. There are historical examples, some of you might know, of the drug called erythropoietin. Erythropoietin was launched by J&J some years back. When they changed the process for erythropoietin manufacture, there was a very serious side effect reported in literature called PRCA. Anybody knows what is PRCA? PRCA, anybody? Thanks, sir. So, yeah, you can say that, yes. It is pure red cell aplasia. Pure red cell aplasia. So I'm asking the question just to find out that if this audience is not aware of PRCA, how will a doctor be aware of PRCA? If he's not aware of PRCA, you can remain in the problems. In Europe, for example, when you report an adverse event of a biosimilar, you have to report it by brand name and batch number. Because there is a risk of unusual side effects coming up with a biosimilar. And imagine now that we have so many biosimilars, as Dr. Pranjal said, 70 in India. Supposing out of the 70, let's say 2-3 brands have unusual side effects. And the market has all the stories. And all our media which is supporting us right now, because we are doing great innovation, the same media will pounce on us. So like we have killed clinical trials, we might even kill the biosimilar industry by kind of rampant prescriptions without being given by unaware doctors and with no robust pharmacovigilance. And this is my worry that sometimes in our need to become successful commercial, as a country, we might do something which might take us down. For example, today we are all troubled by this quality issues in generic and biochemical industry world over. So one rotten apple can really, mess up the whole fruit basket. So my urge as a doctor and industry person that let's do something which is pragmatic, rational, and not aggressive with the doctors right now till they understand what they are doing and then benefit all of us. Otherwise, we have a risk of actually taking the market down very quickly in several years because something will happen. We don't know. That's my take on this issue.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Bhatt. Let's hear Samir about process development and molecular parameters for biosimilars with respect to clinical relevance. I think that's something very important. What happens in the lab at the development stage or maybe even at the afterwards in the production, how does it affect patient outcome or patient usage of the product?
Thank you very much, Dr. Bote. So, you know, as what Dr. Bhatt just mentioned, you know, one rotten apple can actually mess up the entire basket. I represent the industry in India. I have been like, you know, associated with the biopharma industry for the last maybe 15 years or so. And what he says is absolutely correct. Like, you know, he gave an example of erythropoietin, you know, this PRCA incidence that actually happened. Why did that happen? The simple reason it happened was erythropoietin was developed by Amgen, where initially the formulation contained human serum albumin, recombinant human serum albumin. It was replaced by J&J into a simpler excipient polysorbate. Now when that happened, that cap that was used, that cap was not Teflon lined, because of which it actually started leaching out rubber, you know, plasticizers. These plasticizers ended up oxidizing that particular molecule into it, and this oxidized molecule was ending up resulting into PRCA. So this was all a conclusion of a very complex investigation that happened eventually because of this PRCA incidence. But because of that particular thing, fortunately, the entire biologics industry did not suffer at that point. Obviously, like, you know, there were a lot of these requirements in the world wherein, you know, particularly from the monoclonal antibody side and, like, you know, treating the cancer indication, a lot of these molecules were developed, were being developed by, you know, many of these players, and some of the pioneers were Amgen and, you know, we heard in the morning, Dr. Kukreja, who represents Roche Genentech. So now coming to, like, you know, what I wanted to bring on to this particular subject. When we say that we are talking about a biosimilar, and when we essentially, like, you know, go to a doctor trying to sell that biosimilar, do we really from the industry tell the doctor what are those critical features in that particular biosimilar which is going to impact or not impact that patient? And this is something which is very critical for the doctor to understand. And I would urge, like, you know, so I saw that, like, you know, one gentleman here is a practicing doctor. Dr. Arun Bhatt is also a clinician. You know, one of the things that I have experienced, like when I used to represent a company, and my company used to essentially, like, you know, try and get a slot into these medical conferences, you know, the clinical conferences. And there, basically, my objective was to essentially tell the doctors, say, for example, a certain monoclonal antibody, what is that critical feature which can make or break that antibody? Now, in that kind of a situation, I usually used to get, like, not more than 10 minutes to talk. And it is not possible for me to explain anything within 10 minutes. So this, and I mean, I'm not blaming the doctors because they had come to that particular conference to hear the clinicians, to hear, like, you know, what the clinical data actually talks about for a certain molecule this way or that way. And this is something which, like, you know, I think at least the doctors or the oncologists or the rheumatoid arthritis, you know, practicing doctors, they really need to, you know, get into the nitty-gritties of this to really understand what are those molecular features which actually can make or break that molecule. Now, to give some examples. Now, in a monoclonal antibody, basically there are, like, you know, these impurities called deamidated species, which is, you know, if we talk on a molecular term, it's a charged species which is negatively charged. But deamidation is not the only species which results into negative charges. There are, you know, certain other species like glycation, which happens as a modification during cell culture. And that particular glycation, what it does is, it actually changes the primary amine on the lysine derivative or the lysine amino acid into a secondary amine. Because of that, one charge is lost and that particular molecule becomes an acidic molecule. Now, the number of glucose which actually go and sit on that particular antibody dictates how much is the negativity of that molecule. Now, everyone might be aware that there is a concept called isoelectric point for a protein. Isoelectric point is nothing but the pH, I mean, the pH of a certain solution at which that protein essentially has neutral charges, or it does not have, you know, an overall charge. When that happens, these proteins actually come together and they aggregate. So during the entire process of a molecular development, what, you know, the molecule is going through different process conditions, the pH is going upwards, downwards, also are happening. Innovator organizations would pounce on it. And with, like, you know, I don't see Dr. Kukreja here anywhere near. But, you know, these are things which are very real. I mean, any such incidents, and we are really going to suffer big time. And as what Dr. Bhatt said, we will lose the opportunity, which is a very big opportunity, because it is actually, you know, slated to become by 2020, almost 2020 or 2025, almost 40 molecules are expected to go off patent, which means there are 40 opportunities of biosimilars to come in. And if we lose this particular opportunity, and India is very well placed, let me tell you, we have some very good organizations in the country with some very good skill set. There are people who understand these molecular technologies, they understand the process technologies, and the regulatory agencies in India are actually, like, you know, coming up very dramatically. Although there is one specific gap in the regulatory agency, which is there is nobody in the DCGI who is sitting who understands the molecule. I mean, at least in my experience, whenever I have visited the DCGI and I have defended a certain, like, you know, product that I am talking about, I don't see anybody who actually understands the chemistry of this particular molecules. Everyone over there is a clinician. And they are only interested in ye kaam karega ya nahi karega. And if, well, I mean, like, you know, so the people who are sitting there, they are basically, you know, looking at it from the clinical trial point of view. Even in the morning, we had a lot of discussions on the clinical trials, and then there was one particular comment, you know, number of patients required for a clinical study. Well, and Anita, I think, you know, just mentioned about residual uncertainty. When we say residual uncertainty, how do you target that? How do you essentially get rid of that residual uncertainty? That is how your statistical calculations for the number of patients are to be dictated. If there is a certain feature, like I said, you know, there is a certain amount of acidic variant which is different than the innovator product, or there are certain features which can be different. Biosimilarity, as explained by US FDA, or the, you know, general definition for biosimilarity is any differences that are acceptable which do not lead into clinically relevant implications. Now, this statement in itself pretty much talks about biosimilarity. So you can accept differences which do not lead to any clinical implications. For example, there is a feature called lysine variants in monoclonal antibody. Lysine variants are C-terminal lysines, and these C-terminal lysines, the moment you inject that particular molecule into a patient, the carboxypeptidase sitting in the blood is going to chop off that particular lysine. So any amount of variation in the C-terminal lysine is an acceptable feature. So this is something which is already known. So nobody needs to really break their brain or break their, like, you know, efforts into trying and match the lysine variant with the innovator. But at the same time, as I mentioned, the acidic variants, we need to really characterize it. In the morning, Anu was talking about, like, you know, the SIAC system, that with the CESI, we can actually go ahead and do that particular charge variant analysis. It is an extremely important analysis, because charge variants, as I mentioned, the isoelectric points of these charges are going to end up aggregating the protein, maybe not immediately, but during the shelf life. And typically, this shelf life, you know, in an industry would be generated at a very early stage of the process. So as and when that particular thing goes towards, you know, filing, you may or may not have even, like, you know, observed that. So these are, like, you know, certain gaps which really need to be thought about before we move forward and, you know, jump into that particular game of biosimilars. I mean, it's easy to say biosimilars, but, like, you know, as an analogy I gave, when somebody is talking about a small molecule generic, it's like trying to duplicate a bicycle. But when we are talking about a monoclonal antibody, you're talking about duplicating an A380 where every nut and bolt has to match the same. So this is not an easy game at all. I mean, we have been talking about complexity, complexity, complexity. What is that complexity? We need to know what is that complexity. Not just we, even the doctors need to know what it is.
Yeah, Samir, one point which I would like you to highlight is we're talking about biosimilar, but what about the biodifferences? As a molecular scientist or the product development guys, you understand the product differences much better than anyone. And how do you relate these differences will reflect in clinical setting? And how would you explain these differences, or what do you expect in a patient outcome or patient usage, rather, say pharmacovigilance or maybe acceptance and safety, and of course efficacy of that product in terms of the differences? Because the differences can be very crucial, and which only development guys will understand much better, because you're analyzing 150 batches and from different continents, different standards, different products from the different countries, and you understand these differences much better than anyone. But how will you translate that knowledge into clinical use? That is one question.
So, I mean, again, I can use, like, you know, thank you for that question. Actually, it's very relevant right now. I can use the example of, say, trastuzumab or rituximab. Now, both these molecules have effector functions, right? So what do you mean by effector function? Effector function is basically a ADCC or a CDC function, which is triggered by the FC portion of that particular molecule. So when we say FC portion, there is a glycan sitting over there in a monoclonal antibody. Now, this glycan, certain specific features of this glycan actually have very strong implications on the activity of that particular molecule. Now, for example, a fucosylation or fucosylation as such out of this glycan, essentially the absence of that fucosylation, which is called as a fucosylation, and the extent of this absence of fucosylation defines whether you will end up getting a biosimilar molecule. So say, for example, trastuzumab generated by a biosimilar company B1 versus trastuzumab, which is Herceptin produced by Roche. These two molecules, when we say that, like, you know, we are taking several lots and we are measuring out what is the Roche proportion of a fucosylation versus what is my proportion of a fucosylation, it needs to really match. Or at least it has to be fairly close enough such that it does not result into a clinically different efficacy proportion. Similarly, galactosylation essentially has an impact on the CDC, that is complement dependent cytotoxicity. So now, effector function based molecules like trastuzumab or rituximab will have very strong implications on their efficacies if these things are not matched. But there are molecules like bevacizumab. Now, bevacizumab is nothing but a simple binding molecule, which is essentially it goes and, like, you know, targets the vascular endothelial factor, VEGF receptor, from its Fab region. It does not have a FC region which is, like, you know, really contributing in any which way in its activity. So there, certain differences are still acceptable, because nobody is, like, you know, really going to end up having very strong clinically, you know, relevant differences if smaller amount of differences exist in the glycan of that particular molecule. So these are, like, you know, certain nuances that really one needs to study when we essentially get into that.
Are these translated into specifications, whatever differences you are, especially for the trastuzumab?
So when we talk about specifications, and that is where that particular point which Anita raised in the morning of comparator, how do we really do that? I mean, you need to have several lots of the innovator molecule, not just lots of the innovator molecule. In my opinion, I prefer that you get several lots from different geographies, because even an innovator molecule, you will find these differences, and you really need to define your range. What is the range that you are targeting? And that particular, I mean, as a biosimilar, I would definitely prefer to have a wider range, because the innovator molecule is established in the market, and if you are able to actually get that particular thing within that range, then you are safe. Safe in the sense, you are safe that you are sending a product which essentially will be, you know, meritorious when it goes into a patient.
Yeah, thank you, Samir. Dr. Chakravarti, I think this becomes a relevant point for you to take forward. And what is USP experience in terms of standards for such products?
See, as I said in my talk in the morning, that the standards for similarity, which is actually the reference product, that's something different from the reference standard, what we are talking about. So yes, as I say, give you one example in the morning, that when we choose to develop a standard, especially in the areas of monoclonal antibody and all that, we find it out, we have seen it before, because we have done a couple of studies with NABSC, that the so-called biosimilars, which are sold at different countries as biosimilar, if we really test them, we can't find them suitable to take it up for a reference standard. This is an issue, and this is an issue which is very important, I think all of us have to remember. And that's where you see the challenge what the companies of, suppose India, China, or Latin America, they face when they go to US or Europe. Because most of these countries, the guidelines and the way the approval is done, unfortunately, that allows lot of products which will never go through in a rigorous review of FDA or EMA are there as biosimilars in these countries. And this is not I'm talking about here. I'm talking about different other countries because I move around several parts of the world. I have gone to Russia, I go to regularly to China. I have gone to Latin America and I have seen the issues there. But one good thing is there is the regulators of these countries today, they realize that the risk what they are exposing their country people. So I gave you one example of China. 5 years back when I went to China, that was one of the, because I was involved in the WHO's first guideline of biosimilars, drafting that guideline. So that was a meeting on that, and the Chinese FDA head came in that meeting, and he said that, see, don't look at China as only Shanghai or Beijing. I have a lot of poor people, so I cannot have a FDA kind of guidelines in our country, then many of my people will die. Today, I'm talking 4 years down the line, CFDA, CHP working very closely with us. The reason is they realize there are several products. One of them is Enbrel, which you know Cipla has actually licensed one of their products from a Chinese company. There is a serious issue on that particular product, which was identified afterwards. So then, now they are working with us to tighten their regulation and see to it that their goal is very clear, that we want to make our regulation as strict as FDA. Now, of course, China has an advantage. If government decide they want to make a strict rule, they can do it. Nobody can protest. In our country, I know there might be a lot of protests. Different political parties will take different side, and that will be an issue. But end of the day, that has to be done. And also another issue is that many of the these regulatory people, including the that what both Samir and Dr. Bhatt said, the people who are involved in the testing laboratories of these government agencies, as well as people who approve those, have very little idea about how to review this data and how to take a call. That's an area where USP is also working with both here with NIB, DCGI, IPC, and also in China, and also in Latin America with ANVISA, really to train these people so that they can understand that what are the quality attributes, what they need to check, so that the quality of these countries really go up. And that ultimately, because that will also be beneficial for the manufacturers, because today, a manufacturer, the way he put a drug into the Indian market, when he goes to an advanced market, so much more work that company has to do, it is unimaginable. So if they can have a little strict at the beginning and in these countries there, so I think there will be a lot more harmonization on the quality of the products, what you see in these countries.
Yeah, and as Samit mentioned about shelf life and its outcome on effect on outcome on in the patients, how do you see shelf life of a reference product or reference standard which you have, and how do you compare at the beginning and at the end of the shelf life? Is there any studies being done or reports being
Yes, reference product it does, and there are several cases of that. That's exactly the reason I told in the morning that any biosimilar companies, they know they have to do it at different stages of the shelf life to get the range, what it is there. The reason is you can fight with the regulator that, yes, I saw innovator product has this to this range, and people didn't die with that. They were efficacious, so why don't you accept that range in my case? And many cases the regulator accept that because they have the clinical data to show that. So in case of reference standard, what we do is we have a parallel study going on, looking at the characteristics of our products. It's not only us, it is done by WHO, the NIBSC, they do the same study. So there are some vials which are always kept parallel to the shelf life and whatever expiry we gave. And at different intervals, we check to it. And if there is a drift we observe, we immediately recall that and inform all the manufacturers who uses that.
Yeah, but you have data from patient usage point of view, at which shelf life stage they use the particular product. I mean, is that data really available?
No, I don't think that data is available. Yeah, you have to generate that data.
That would be very difficult data to get, actually.
Nobody will give, because then you are giving a biosimilar company an advantage that with that variation, it is acceptable. So it is a challenge. It is a challenge for a biosimilar company. And unfortunately, that's they have to do.
Yeah, let's come to our Indian perspective. Pankaj has working with Hetero, and they have a lot of experience in Indian market as far as biosimilar is concerned. And how do you meet demands of post-marketing phase of biosimilar? I mean, what is your experience in post-marketing scenario? Because you have large number of products in India.
Yeah, that's true. Thanks, Dr. Bode, and thanks, Virtue Insight, and thanks to Dr. Shubhdeep Sinha, who was supposed to attend this session. And because of some reason, he's not here, and that's the reason I'm sitting here on the panel. So as correctly mentioned by Dr. Prashant, like we have, a couple of biosimilars and which are in the post-marketing surveillance phase, and there are few in the clinical stage as well. So as from the India's perspective, like we have recent biosimilar guidelines, which has been released last year in August 2016, which clearly says, and there is no more term which is called as a post-marketing surveillance. They call it as a phase four studies. And they have specified about the sample size as well, and what needs to be done, why needs to be done, from the safety point of view. So we have to do a safety tolerability, and apart from that, you have to do a immunogenicity study as well. And the sample size, which is the minimum bare sample size, has been defined as 200 patients. But again, I'm saying it's a minimum bare, and we are doing trial in, even in 500 plus patients. We have already completed a trial. So we are discussing about this specific number, sample size number 100, 200 in test arm and 200 in post-marketing surveillance setting. So this is the minimum number, at least you have to do in this many patients. You can always go beyond that. So we have completed 500 patient study for darbepoetin, which has been marketed by all top Indian pharmaceutical companies. Basically, we are into B2B business. So we manufacture and give it to our marketing partners. And we have all top 10 Indian pharma who are marketing our darbepoetin in India. So that is the one part of the PMS stroke phase 4 studies, which is applicable as per Indian regulatory guidelines, which has been released by CDSCO last year, 2016. And I think I answered your question.
What challenges do you see if you want to go out of India to develop a product? I mean, how we would propose to go about it?
See, frankly speaking, we are talking about the Indian companies, and we are talking about the MNCs right from morning sessions. So I clearly see there are two buckets here. One is with a vision marketing the product biosimilar across globe, and with a vision with a limited focus like a developing countries in India, then in ROW countries. So we come from that bucket, and with a specific vision. So that's the strategic decision which has been taken by Indian pharmaceutical companies. And there are developments happening globally as well. We have, plans. In fact, we have entered in ROW countries where the data has been presented, which has been conducted in India. And they are more, they are more interested in analytical characterization part than into the clinical part. So the science comes from there, and that's what our experience when we approached different regulatory authorities in ROW countries. And we have some plans to start global clinical trials as well, But that was a typical strategic decision, starting with India and then with ROW, and then going into US and Europe.
I think Samir has more idea, but I think what I've read is that to develop a biosimilar, even a big company has to spend about maybe 6 to 8 years and about maybe $300 million. So obviously our company should not be spending so much time and effort. But it's going to be it's not our cup of tea right now. Unless we do something which is like a consortium approach, that people come together to develop one molecule which is quality and globally effective, then yes. But otherwise we are stuck with it. And second point I want to mention, that as Samir mentioned about the other companies kind of trying to promote against the Indian companies, already happening. I saw a presentation for medical doctors, a CME program, where even slide of biosimilar, they mentioned that a biosimilar is one which has been approved by a regulatory authority like EMA or FDA. But where the laws are not stringent, it's not biosimilar, it could be a biocopy or biomimetic. So that's only they are kind of telling the doctors outside India.
I can add a few perspectives into this. So when we say we want to take it out of the country, and I think whatever in my experience, the principal requirement for that is to ensure that the residual uncertainties are addressed. And now how do you address those residual uncertainties? One way is to ensure that your data package, which consists of your analytical characterization, as what Pankaj was just mentioning, that the analytical characterization really is built up. You don't just do size-based differences or charge-based differences. You actually go into the nitty-gritties of it. And like what in the morning we heard on the mass spec talk, you actually go ahead, identify the HCPs, identify what are those HCPs, ensure every characterization is done, understand any and every uncertainty which exists in that particular product against the one which is already marketed in that specific geography. Now, that is one way of doing it. Whatever is now residual, where you still see that there are certain differences, those differences necessarily will have to be addressed through the clinical trials. And if you look at the typical numbers that clinical trials have used for the products which are already marketed in the US, for example, just a couple of days back, we heard that Biocon got the approval for their trastuzumab. And if I'm not wrong, their number was close to 500 plus. So, that was their, pivotal study for the safety efficacy of it. Now, there is one way we have been hearing about, the post-marketing or the pharmacovigilance piece of it. One way of actually trying to generate this information is by understanding how these products have behaved in the Indian market from the safety point of view. And when we say safety point of view, it cannot be just arbitrary, calling the doctor and getting the information. It will have to be more of a structured study wherein you already have marked out what you are going to look out for. And the regulations outside, the regulated markets are going to really, regulatory agencies are going to look at what sort of information have you generated as a planned information. And that is going to again help you reduce this residual uncertainty. So these are certain, I believe, ways through which we might be able to really reach that particular objective of taking the products outside the country, or I wouldn't call it outside the country, but to the regulated markets. And let's not be infatuated that doing in India or the ROW, we will get our returns. Yes, we will make money. There's no doubt about it. There are certain smaller markets, like for example, the Latin American market, although it's a smaller market, but it's a serious market. Or the CIS countries, these are serious markets. And a lot of money is actually possible to be done over there. But the real money that you can get is from the regulated markets, which is US, Europe, Australia, Japan. So these are the places where I would say as an industry person, that is where your profits are really, really going to come back in. And that is how you would be able to justify the investments which go into this sort of, projects. And these investments are not minor. The overall development of a laboratory followed by the clinical studies, these are actually fairly expensive. We say that this is biosimilar. And one of the things which Dr. Bhatt earlier mentioned, that yes, there is a 30-40% drop. And I would agree. There is no way that you can drop it beyond that.
Because for a small molecule, you don't need a clinical trial. For this, you actually need a pivotal clinical trial. You are still spending a lot of money, and which you have to recover once you hit the market. And there is very little patience, at least in the, you know, executives, to really make the money back. And that is what really, like, you know, drives these particular numbers of pricing. And in many of the geographies that our companies really go in, you know, you don't really have options. So even if it is a 30-40% drop, it is still a, you know, acceptable drop, because the other fellow is actually selling it that much more higher, I mean the innovator. But at the same time, as what we have been emphasizing on, we need to really understand what we are subjecting the patients to. And that is something which is, you know, to be looked at from a much more granular point of view, in the form of molecular characterization, in the form of what that clinical trial was designed for, what those outcomes were, what the endpoints were, how many patients were used into it, did it really address the residual uncertainties, if not completely, but to an extent where the cost benefits are now exceeding.
Yeah, now there is time for audience and panelist interaction. We can have some comments or questions from the audience.
Thank you, panel. It was a nice discussion to hear, and I'm Anupam from Novartis Healthcare, and I have few inquiries. It might look novish, but I want to know. So like you said, Mr. Pankaj, that you are going to ROW markets, expanding the horizon. So are the Indian study data have been accepted in the ROW markets when you go with the biosimilars into out ROW countries?
Yes, it is very much acceptable. That's what I was trying to, you know, discuss during the discussion, that they are mainly looking into the characterization, analytical characterization data. And if they want any additional data, then they, you know, then upfront they tell us that, you know, this data is required. So you can go back again, you know, again submit the additional dossier which is required. So clinical is the one part, but they are mainly looking into the lab data as well. And as far as the guidelines are concerned, you know, we are following Indian guidelines, which has been released by our Indian regulators. We have a Schedule Y, which is a law of land. So all this data is acceptable. There is no concern, like, you know, in terms of data acceptability. As long as you are able to present this data, you know, in a proper format, you are confident enough about your data, and this is very much acceptable. We have been to Argentina recently, where the data was presented. So what they said, that we have done a phase 3 study where we have studied the PK, PD, as well as the immunogenicity data. So they asked us to present data as a subset of analysis. Initially, the data was presented as a complete study, but they wanted into a subset, like the CSRs were asked in the subsets of PK, PD, and then for the immunogenicity. So again, for immunogenicity, they suggested that you need to have a long-term immunogenicity data. So you can follow up those patients, and you can collect the samples and then check the long-term effects in terms of any antibody developments are there. So this kind of suggestions we receive.
Thank you.
But
so
upfront, they don't deny that, you know, they listen to us basically.
Yeah, that's.
And probably you can add to one question. If study may be Indian, but if protocol is globally compliant in terms of requirements, then we are there. I mean, we don't have to have such segregation that this Indian study, or as long as study is conducted properly and it was designed properly.
Thank you very much. I have one more inquiry. The pharma innovator companies, when they register a pharma product into, you know, more regulated markets, so they have going through this structured benefit risk approach. So like EMEA, they are having feeling the effect table as a structured benefit risk approach. For the biologics also, I'm sure the innovators are doing that. Whether in biosimilars also, the biosimilar manufacturers are also having that kind of similar structured benefit risk approach for the submissions?
I would say yes. I mean, it's not really for the, you know, industry to really take a decision on it. It's more for the regulatory agencies to really, like, you know, look into it. What is the benefit of, you know, bringing that particular biosimilar,
And that would probably depend on, you know, perhaps what is the availability of that particular product in the market and what is the affordability of that product in the market. So these are certain, I would say, you know, riders on which a regulatory decision probably would be based on. But yes, I mean, having said that, I'm pretty certain that pretty much all the, I would call advanced regulatory agencies, and India being one of them now, at least in this particular field, I mean, the reason I'm calling it advanced is because they have this particular mindset. They know that they cannot really let any nonsense come into the market. So they are going to ensure that what is the risk associated with this particular product and whether that risk is essentially still, you know, supposed to be taken because the current requirement in the market is this. And I believe that, I think most of the regulatory agencies, you know, more or less work with this mindset. And it is applicable for the innovator guys in the case of orphan drugs, for example, right? So this is very much there. And so, yeah, I mean, I think, like, you know, that's probably it.
Yeah, even pharmaceutical companies also would not like to work on orphan biosimilars as of now. We have, the biosimilar industry has to reach that stage. It's long away, still, I can feel.
Thanks to all panel members for the discussion. My question, couple of questions are there regarding the immunogenicity study. I think that is also important part as well as PKPD. I think for the immunogenicity study, we are putting a positive case, right? So in the positive case, shall we put only a single positive case or the persistent positive antibody for the test arm as well as the reference arm? This is my first question. And the second one is, what is your experience regarding the cosmetic use? Because in the US and Europe, the more cosmetic products are used, so chances of antibody are more positive with PEG whenever the biosimilar trials are ongoing in that those countries. So, and which kind of strands we have to take or which precautions we have to take to nullify this trend?
I think basically it should be comparable in both arms. That's the question. No? You can't say that I have antibodies in my biosimilar arm, but not in biologics. So that's the way. But I mean, Pankaj can give you a better answer.
Yeah, just to brief you about the immunogenicity studies, you know, for phase 3 and phase 4, basically. Again, there are two types. Like in phase 3, it's in a controlled fashion. You have a clinical trials, sites where the patients has been recruited, and you are going to collect the samples. And what you have seen, it depends mainly on what kind of biosimilar you are handling. If you are handling adalimumab, where there are chances, it's autoimmune kind of, you know, so there are chances of developing antibodies are more. TNF-alpha is already there, and, you know, so what we have seen that there are comparable antibodies have been seen in both the arms, the test as well as the reference drug. So. And this is justifiable in terms of being adalimumab, which is, you know, again, a biosimilar. And the second is you have to correlate with the safety as well. What kind of adverse effects you are observing along with the immunogenicity. So it's a complete kind of analysis which goes, you know, hand in hand. And then you can see what is the statistical difference, like how many patients have developed the antibodies at what stage. There could be possibility that antibodies being present right from the baseline when you screen the patient. So there are different time points where you screen the antibodies, baseline, then after giving the treatment, and to see the long-term effect at 12 months, say. So that way you can see the development of antibodies.
Right, sir. But sometimes, sir, at this time, the immunogenicity studies, the majority, the adaptive trial approach is there. So at that time, whenever you are analyzing the data in the blended mirror, you don't know about the test part and the reference part. And the, if the product has a very low immunogenicity rate and the false positive rate is there, then your sample size became 400, 500, and 600. So at that time, how we should take care? Because it's a complete new approach is there, and many companies are applying for that. And the PEG part means, I have also come across to the articles, for the cosmetic use, they are definitely positive for the PEG part. And if your interim analysis, the highest percentage of the antibody positive rate is there, then definitely the statistical sample size onto the higher
side. That's true. So basically, you have to look into the molecule which you are developing. That is the one part. What is the literature data which is available? Because the studies have been done earlier as well by the innovator product. So that is the second part. And the overall conclusion, you have to see what is the clinical significance. if there is a development of antibodies, what time point has been developed at baseline or interim or long term, that you have to see, and then overall you have to see what is the clinical impact, and overall data needs to be presented.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, Dr. Rahul Hole wants to add something.
That was the last comment.
Yeah, thanks Pankaj for the comprehensive answer. I just added to what you said is to his question that not all antibodies or other, the antibodies are not pegylated, you know, per se. In case, so not all antibodies are pegylated. So this peg, you know, being very prevalent in the cosmetic, which is very ubiquitously used, is not a concern for all the molecules, one. And secondly, not just the presence of antibodies or anti-drug antibodies that is concerning, the neutralizing antibodies is something which is of greater importance and significance. So as long as there are no neutralizing antibodies, you are still okay with, you know, the titers being on a higher side.
Yeah,
and
that's
as
very
you said,
true.
And as I said, you have the legacy studies, the originator studies, for which you have the data, and you know the you see the rates, you know, which are available. So you can fairly make the judgment.
Yeah, that's very true. So you need to understand what kind of antibodies, as correctly mentioned by Dr. Rahul, if those are the neutralizing antibodies, then further analysis is required.
Yeah.
It is not depend upon the NAB rate. It's not depend upon the NAB rate. NAB rate is, I think, normally it's a zero. As an example, any molecules are there, NAB rate is very onto the lower side. But whenever you are calculating the sample size, the normal ADA rate is going to be calculated, not only NAB.
I think the sample size is on endpoints of efficacy and activity.
But sir, in the immunogenicity study is there. You want to do the study for the immunogenicity only.
Yeah, so the immunogenicity part comes into the secondary endpoint. So the primary endpoint is different. Yeah. That's what Dr. Burt was trying to say.
Okay, fine, sir.
Yeah, thank you very much for audience participation and panelists for their thoughtful insights. We have long way to go as far as biosimilar manufacturing, development, and amalgamation of its details or implications of such development into patients' lives and patients' utilization of biosimilars. There's a lot of insight has to go in that direction as well. We are actually in the dark as far as I can see things are. But there is always hope for a better situation. And with that, I thank all panelists and I thank audience for their participation. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, everybody, for your inputs to the session. And may I request our moderator and the chairperson for the session, Dr. Bode, to please hand out mementos to each one of our speakers for their inputs to. It's Dr. Sameer Kulkarni. Thank you very much, Dr. Kulkarni, for your inputs. Dr. Arun Bhatt, thank you. Let's give a round of applause for Dr. Pankaj Thakur. Thank you very much. Dr. Ranjan has already received his memento. May I request you to please join us on stage for a group photograph with the entire panel. And I'm also going to request Dr. Pranjal Bordoloi to please join us on stage. And for chairing the morning session and, of course, moderating the panel discussion, a memento for Dr. Bordoloi. I would request Dr. Prashant Bode to please hand us over. Thank you once again. And with that, a final group photograph with Dr. Bordoloi. Please do join us. Ladies and gentlemen, as we conclude that panel, we now move forward to the next session.